I think I trust them the least of all.
I've been with you all these years, Malcolm. Doesn't that mean anything?
Only you know if I can trust you. And if I can't, what are you asking for?
Will you at least tell me why you're meeting with him? I mean, I deserve to know that.
Do you remember the first time that you ever made love?
What?
Do you remember the first time that you ever made love?
Yeah, sort of.
Why? Why'd you do it?
What do you mean, why'd I do it?
Why did you do it? Was there a reason behind it? Was it planned, or did it just happen because it was meant to? Because you knew sooner or later it would. Because it was time.
It was mostly because the woman said I could. Rashad.
There's nothing romantic about you.
I think if you weren't my bodyguard, I think you'd be alone.
Well, you share with me most of the time I am.
Did I ever tell you about the time I met Billie Holiday?
Yeah, okay, Malcolm.
She sang a song for me. I ever tell you about that?
She sang a song for you? And Louis Armstrong asked you to play trumpet.
She sang it for me. She walked straight up to me. Ignored everyone else in the room. Took the flower out of her hair, handed it to me. And then she started to sing. You don't know what love is until you've learned the meaning of the blues. Until you've had a love you've had to lose. You don't know what love is. You don't know. Don't know what love is until you've learned the meaning of the blue.
Found the bug again.
Maybe you guys should learn how to hide it better.
Maybe we don't want to hide it that good. Funny what happens to someone when they know they're being watched.
You play mind games with that man, you lose.
Sound like you admire him. Do you?
I've seen guys out on the streets that would walk all over their own mothers. Wouldn't think twice about it. Now, those same dudes will give their lives for that man.
Somehow, I don't think they're gonna have to do that. Well, I suppose it doesn't make sense to keep this on. How long you been doing this?
You mean spying? A couple of years. Joined NYPD in 61.
Hey, you made detective quick.
And a riot's help. Wasn't easy for white detectives to move in and out of Harlem unnoticed. I don't think there were too many volunteers anyway. What about you? How long you been with the Bureau?
Just under 5. Never thought I'd be here.
Maybe you guys should hire some Negroes.
Who do you think put the bug in his room?
You don't really like playing chess with me, do you?
No.
Why?
Because I always beat you. Checkmate.
I've become that predictable?
You play as if the object of the game is to protect the pawns. The pawns are there to protect the king, Malcolm.
Maybe it's time somebody protected the pawns for a change, Rashad.
Then it wouldn't be a game of chess anymore. It would be something else. Something nobody would play.
Yeah, that would be so bad.
It's not a question of good or bad. It's a question of living or dying.
Nothing is to happen to my family. Now they're not a part of this game, Rashad.
Do you think you should let him in?
You know what I think.
Malcolm?
Reverend. Rashad, you can leave us alone. I'll be all right.
I need to check Dr. King.
The check? I was checked once downstairs.
Not by me.
Rashad, somehow this seems all unnecessary. I'm sure I'll be safe with Dr. King.
I'm sure you will be safe with Dr. King, too. But how do I know that's him?
Perhaps I could deliver a short speech on appropriate
summit. Oh, no, summit. Please, doctor. Not that, Rashad. I'll be fine.
Very well, if you say so. Can I take your coat, Dr. King?
Why, yes. Thank you.
I'll be just outside if you need me. Salaam alaikum.
Wa alaikum salaam. I'm sorry about that. These are troubled times.
I understand. I suppose the bombing has unsettled everyone.
Yeah, well, it didn't do too much for the price of real estate in my neighborhood. Did anyone see you come in?
No, I followed your directions, however. The next time you asked me to use the back stairs, I'd appreciate it if you'd find a room on a floor lower than the seventh.
I've seen you on TV. You can afford to lose a pound or two.
Television makes you look heavier. Besides, this stomach is in the finest sense of Southern tradition and the ministry. Congregations don't warm up to a thin preacher. It means the preacher's not good enough to receive those sweet potato pies in lieu of other donations.
My congregation does sell pies from street to street. You might say it keeps them thin, but it keeps the donations fat. Speaking of pies, Doctor, is that your lunch you got in that bag there? Or did you, you bring a tape recorder?
Now, why would I need a tape recorder?
But you might be nervous about coming in and out of these hotel rooms. You know, Mr. Hoover does have a way of making people paranoid.
I never thought the good Lord could make a mistake. However, Mr. Hoover does push one's faith beyond reasonable limits.
Yes, sir. Have a seat. You don't want the comfortable chair, huh?
This will do nicely, thank you.
Oh, yes, I forgot. You're used to them sit-ins and stuff, huh?
I find it better for your back.
And not too good for your head, as I recall. I'm surprised that you still have one with all that non-violent action you've been involved in.
You'd be amazed what you can take when the purpose is clear.
Perhaps, but I think some folks just naturally have hard heads.
He never answered my question. You admire him?
Doesn't deserve to be following around if that's what you're asking.
Don't you think somebody who tells your people to arm themselves is dangerous?
Yes. I think anyone who tells my people to arm themselves is dangerous.
Well, at least we agree on that. You want me to take the window for a while?
Hey, and don't throw out that section about his house being bombed. I haven't finished reading it.
Why don't you try to find out who did it? You know, when I was in Selma 2 weeks ago, I almost paid you a little visit.
You should have. There was plenty of room in the jail.
I try not to visit jails voluntarily.
I heard your speech on my behalf was very moving.
Well, the younger people seemed to enjoy it. In fact, if I had spoken any longer, we all would have come by that jailhouse to pay you a little visit. Of course, I doubt there'd be much jail remaining after we left.
I should thank you for not speaking too long. Being in jail is uncomfortable enough. Having it torn down while you're there is not my idea how to spend a Sunday afternoon.
Don't thank me. Thank your conference planners for that one. Had it been up to them, I wouldn't have spoken at all. As it was, they spent several hours after I left trying to calm the crowd down.
Perhaps they were trying to move them in a different direction.
Calming them down certainly would have done that.
Well, since you didn't come to see me then, I'm here to see you now.
Yes, and I must say, I am impressed. I know you don't visit these northern cities very often. I imagine our city streets are a little more difficult to maneuver than those country roads you're accustomed to, huh?
Malcolm, if the road was meant to be traveled, it will be.
What if it's destroyed?
It will be rebuilt. Well, it wasn't a road for us.
Still the dreamer.
Still a revolutionary.
Thank you.
I wasn't aware I'd paid you a compliment.
Ignorance is sometimes the sincerest form of flattery.
Well, Malcolm, if I didn't know better, I would think you were trying to upset me.
Man who allows himself to be hit upside the head shouldn't be upset at some mere words now. Yeah, I'll get this out of the way. Care for some water?
No, thank you.
What about some coffee or...
I'm fine.
Tea? I want you to eat this.
No, thank you. I'm not hungry.
I don't care. I want you to eat it anyway.
I don't want it.
But it's good for you.
That may be. I still don't want it.
What if I make you eat it?
How would you go about doing that?
By force, if necessary.
I'd still refuse.
You mean to tell me you'd refuse to eat this apple even if I resorted to force?
Yes.
Even though it's good for you.
Even so.
You're right, Doctor. You can't force people to take something they do not want. Now, you try as hard as you can to make these white folks love us. I don't care how smooth you make it. The simple fact is, they are just not willing to swallow the truth, even though it's good for them.
Isn't it odd that you should try to tempt me with an apple?
You see, the apple as a temptation, I see it as nourishment.
Oh, we see what we want it.
Some of us don't see anything, even when it's staring us straight in the face. Passed by the front of the hotel. Did you notice a woman standing out front? She had on a short red skirt, a lot of makeup.
And the prostitute?
Yeah. How old would you guess she is?
30, 35.
She's 17. Although after 3 years out on the streets, age has no real significance. Tomorrow morning, she won't know how many men she slept with tonight. She can't tell by the money she makes. A pimp collects that right after every trip. She's part of a larger congregation, Doctor, but you won't find them in your churches. They'd curse your God if they were alive enough to curse, but they're dead. They're the living dead. They exist because they're accustomed to it. They haven't even thought about why they shouldn't. Weren't so used to moving around all the time, not staying in one place too long, someone would have come along and just swept them away by now.
I suppose you have a point to all this.
When you're around the same people every day, you don't notice change right away. Then all of a sudden you're aware someone is old or fat or without hope.
The purpose of all this, Martin, is to show you the hopeless and let you know that that number grows every day.
You have a solution.
Unity.
I have always supported unity, Malcolm.
Yeah, Martin, but your type of unity is sitting around the campfire singing, "We shall overcome," while a cross is burning. Now, if you're really for unity, you'd be singing, "We shall come over," anytime black people need to stop white people from persecuting them. "We shall come over," and we'll stay there until they feel safe again.
We also sang, "Ain't gonna let nobody turn us around."
That's a good tune, but nobody ever got the freedom from singing. Now, on the other hand, if you're prepared to do a little swinging.
Violence. Revenge. Is that the unity you seek?
I do not seek violence. I seek to stop violence, and I'll do that by any means necessary.
Violence never stopped violence.
But marches do. All these people are gathered together singing songs. Where'd you get a piece of legislation?
Yes. Birmingham got us a civil rights bill. And Selma will get us voters' rights legislation.
You got nothing. Nothing but some more empty promises and a piece of paper that betrayed yet another lie and a long list of lies. The American lie, that grand white lie. You know how to dream tonight?
Oh?
We were both dead. We've been dead for some time. Young black men and women didn't know who we were. They knew nothing about the struggle, revolution. It was as if it had never happened. We'll be sold out, you and I. It may happen over the promise for a job or a deal to be supported as a new leader. Could happen in any number of ways, but it'll happen. You might even do it to yourself, Martin.
How would I accomplish my own undermining?
If you seek to hurt our bodies, we will strive to heal your souls. If you bomb our homes and churches, we will build them again.
With forgiveness and hope, despise us if you will, and we'll answer your hate with compassion and love.
Threaten our children, and we will still ask them to love you. Dishonor our fathers and mothers, and we will still treat you
with respect. Beat us if you must,
and we will still pray for you. Use the full force of violence against our families, and we will use only the weapon of love in our defense. And our pain lies your salvation, and to that end, we suffer with no regret. Did you really say that?
You know I did, and you know the context.
The context had to be insanity.
Is love insane,
man? No, we're not talking about love.
Perhaps you'd better read it again.
No, thank you. I try not to inflict suffering on myself more than once. I find that my capacity for that is not as large
as
yours.
You're not before the cameras now, Malcolm. You have an audience of one, and I'm not cheating.
I don't need any cameras, and I don't need any audience.
And I did not come here to debate you, sir. You can stop the contest.
The contest is more important than a debate, Doctor.
Satisfied?
I just wish it was that easy, Doctor.
Malcolm, why is it every time you say the words reverend or doctor, I get the distinct impression I should feel insulted?
Maybe it's my street accent. Not having had the advantage of university training, my words sometimes appear too harsh.
Oh, you too modest. It is doubtful that Harvard would have invited anyone to lecture who had difficulty being understood.
They didn't bring me there to lecture. They brought me there to be embarrassed. But I do not embarrass easily. And since Harvard didn't have anything that I wanted, I didn't see the need to apologize for not having it. Of course, there was an ample number of Negroes there who had an abundance of apologies all saved up for just such an occasion.
And you see me as that kind of Negro?
No. But I do see you as being used by white folks, whether you intend to or not, which is why they'll erect monuments to you before you're through.
Oh, I don't know. It seems to me the very mention of your name is apt to get a great deal of attention. Why, they may even name entire cities after you.
You got the award, Martin.
On behalf of people everywhere who fight against injustice.
White folks gave you the award. Doesn't it bother you just a little bit that the people who are doing all the oppressing seem to be giving out all the awards? I think you must have impressed them the most when you said, if blood must flow in the streets, let it be our blood. Hell, I'll bet every crack in the South would chip in to buy your award on that one.
The award was for peace, Malcolm.
The award was for getting beaten and not fighting back.
You ought to sit down with us sometime and find out what fighting back is all about. Then maybe you can understand what I said.
You're asking me to understand how a black man can ask his own people to be the first, the last, the only ones to bleed?
Did you ever consider that perhaps you are more responsible for our people's blood flowing in the streets than I? That your speeches are unwittingly causing violence?
No, not once, not ever. Aggression in the name of self-defense is not violence, it's honor!
There is no honor in war, Malcolm. No progress can come from violence.
Progress? You got some concessions because I was the alternative. They threw some legislation, a little money, some cracker control programs your way in the hopes that nonviolence would win out. The only problem is we are the only ones running around here being nonviolent. They kill me first, you have nothing to negotiate with. They kill you first, they better not let me live. They'll make you into a martyr, Martin. They'll hold your nonviolent methods up to the world as a testament to your courage. And if they hold them up long enough, they won't even realize the contradiction that you may get killed preaching it.
If I have to die so that my children do not suffer a spiritual death and this country is forced to face up to its injustice, then I'll do that. Jesus Christ gave this movement a spirit 2,000 years ago. Mahatma Gandhi gave it a method. Today, black people in this nation will forge that spirit with that method and create a weapon of love. We will live together as brothers, Malcolm. Or we most certainly will perish as fools.
Martin, that is not the country out there. They stack families on top of families out there. Black man on top of black man till there is no room, till you can't breathe. And when you can't breathe, you die. Or you strike out. Somebody else dies. And then the women. It could be a curse just being young and attractive out here on these streets. But then there's drugs. You pour enough dope into the black community while they'll dream anything. Hell, they'll dream one of your dreams, Martin.
I won't change, Malcolm. I think you know that.
Martin, you gotta change. Anyone can change. That girl out there.
I will not change.
Well, if you will not change, can you at least get angry?
I remember when I led my first march, this huge white man jumps out from the crowd and with all of his might and all of his force yells at the top of his voice, "Go home, you little nigger bastard." He was yelling at a child, Malcolm. Couldn't have been any more than 7 or 8 years old. I saw the look of hurt on that child's face, not just hurt,
fear. But most of all,
it was a shame.
He knew he must have done something terribly wrong to be the focus of all that hate. Oh, yes. I can get angry with all the history that makes me a black man. I can get angry. But it is a different kind of anger. It is an anger that says you can't stop loving. You can't stop believing. You can't stop trying. It is an anger that makes me want to prove hate wrong.
I just want to prove hate less powerful, Martin.
We both deal in power, Malcolm. We just do it differently.
You can only handle power one way. Martin, even when you marched, you needed the protection of the federal government. It took the entire National Guard just to enroll one Negro into college. Now, what do you think all those tanks were doing there to help the students with the...
Those tanks were there because this movement needed to hold up a mirror to this country and, through our pain and suffering, expose its injustice.
It doesn't matter how good a football player you are. If the game is baseball, you better get yourself a bat. If you got a problem swinging it, then stay out of this game.
I would have thought your trips to Mecca would have given you a greater vision, a broader compassion.
You don't tame the lion and leave the jungle unchanged, Martin. Yes, I saw some things outside this country. Outside this country. I saw some whites who, when they spoke of color, almost made it seem incidental, like describing a suit or sunset. But here, in this country, when a man talks of color, you know what he's talking about. You see it in his expression. You hear it in his voice. He means he's on top, and you're not. And there is no way he's going to let that change. It's a simple question of power and privilege. And those in power always decide who gets the privilege. Mark, we're not the ones in power. We won't be the ones in power till we take control of our own lives, our own thinking.
Malcolm, you want to free blacks. I want to free America. It is the only way any of us can be free.
Martin, can't you see what's happening to us 5 years from now? 10 at the most, racists won't have to do anything to us. We'll be doing it to ourselves. Some of these brothers who sit peacefully in your demonstrations and allow their heads to be split open, don't you know they come right back to their own communities and commit violent acts? It's the rage. It's the hurt that's all balled up inside. It makes them strike out in the only way they can, the only way that's acceptable. Now, I cannot free us from that rage, but at least I can direct it to the right source.
Well, don't we both want the same things, Malcolm?
You want us to be able to buy a cup of coffee, I want us to sell it. You want us to integrate a coffee shop, I want us to own it. You want white people to hire us, I want us to hire our own damn self. No, we don't want the same thing. I'm afraid that this quest that you have for integration will wind up being the white man's solution for control. Maybe the only hope we have is that they'll hate us so much they won't even recognize how much power they'd have over us if they just let us in.
And those of us that don't agree with your definition of power and control, I suppose, we're to be called Uncle Tom.
I only refer to the older ones as Uncle, and I don't call them Toms anymore. I call them Roy, I call them Ralph, and I call them Uncle Whitney.
They don't deserve that from you, Malcolm. They don't deserve that from anyone. Do you think the unity you seek can be achieved through insult and ridicule?
Have I ridiculed you, Reverend?
Was I supposed to be flattered by the term the Reverend Dr. Chicken Leg?
It was the Reverend Dr. Chicken Wing, to be precise. Would you have been more flattered had I referred to you as the Lord?
The movement would have been sufficient. I suppose it's time for a rematch.
So there is an ego there to bruise, huh? Isn't it wonderful the way the two of us are getting along?
I was just thinking the same thing. As a matter of fact, I think we'd get along a lot better if you wouldn't just talk so much.
Oh, well, my friend, I am prepared to inflict suffering if you are prepared to endure it. Well, it seems like we're even.
Yes, Malcolm. I suppose we are. Now, is this why you asked me here?
Actually, I'm surprised that you even accepted the invitation.
Came here to offer you my protection.
What?
When I saw this morning about the mom and
protection? You offer me protection? And how are you gonna do that? Sarah, are you gonna have a mass sit in and pray? And maybe this non-violent action movement you got will frighten those Molotov cocktail
throwers. Any Molotov cocktails that were thrown into your home, Malcolm, were thrown there because of your movement, not mine.
Yes. Yes, my movement is flexible. It considers every option. It rules nothing out. Its one goal is freedom, total, absolute, and complete. It does not ask and it does not beg. It takes. It's willing to pay the price of freedom. But those who are not willing to pay that price, they don't want freedom.
Don't set yourself up as an authority on freedom.
No, I wouldn't think of it, Doctor. If I want an authority on freedom, I'll go find me someone who'll let a sheriff put a knot upside his head.
Well, I came here to offer you my help.
Your help. You're helping to kill me.
Oh, am I accused of that,
not
too?
Accused, indicted! This non-violent action movement you got, it's gonna get everybody killed.
Non-violence is the only chance we have. By appealing to the conscience of this country,
The conscience of this country? This country has no conscience. It has no morality. It has no honor. Hell, it doesn't even have a memory. It forgets. But it doesn't want to remember. It forgets. And what we won't allow it to forget, it lies about. This country calls you a hero when you tell black people to be nonviolent here in America, but you tell the same black people to be nonviolent in Vietnam. Stop dropping napalm on little brown-skinned babies, it will call you a traitor. It will call you a coward. You can't appeal to the conscience of a country like that. Looking for kindness, you better look someplace else. Man's out there building gas ovens. You're telling black people not to fight back. When we refuse to defend ourselves, it not only makes it easy for racists to kill us, it makes it justifiable.
And you think that I have contributed to that?
Well, let's just say, Doctor, that anyone who wants to kill me, anyone who wants to kill any black man, they don't have to stop and consider the consequences of their actions. They don't have to stop and ask, now, what will a good doctor do? They know what you'll do. Nothing. Nothing.
That's what this movement of yours has accomplished, Martin. Nothing.
Don't tell me that nothing was accomplished. Don't tell me that people were beaten for nothing. Do you think it's easy for me to sit there and watch our own people beaten? To sit there and risk the lives of my own children? Malcolm, do you think I'd risk my own life for nothing? I don't want to die. I don't want to see our people die. I don't preach nonviolence because I like it. I preach it because it's right. Because I'm a man and a child of God. You look out there on that city and you see neon signs that tell you where to go and what to do. Where I grew up, there were different signs. Oh, they weren't neon. But if you were black, you had no trouble seeing them. There were signs that burned the words for colored only into the psyche of little Negro children. Signs that degraded and humiliated those little children's parents on a daily and a constant and a continuous basis. When those signs came down, the spirit of black people went up. So don't you dare tell me nothing was accomplished. I was sitting in a Montgomery church when the announcement came that buses would no longer be segregated. What was accomplished was written on the faces of those who struggled so hard to prove that you could make a stand by sitting down. The only ones who doubted that anything was accomplished were those who never, never had to get up and give their seat to a white man. Or go to the back of the bus. Or watch white patrons eating in the comfort of a restaurant while you had to take your food outside in the cold and the rain. Don't you diminish what was accomplished. And don't you misunderstand what will be accomplished. Sometimes you got to be able to ride the bus before you can drive it. But that doesn't mean we aren't planning to own the bus line one day. And Malcolm, don't mistake nonviolence for non-action. You do a disservice to those who were beaten so that you might have the courage and the freedom to question their courage.
Now, you wait a minute. I have never questioned the courage. I've questioned the judgment.
And I'm beginning to question my own for coming here in the first place.
Well, that's easily corrected, Doctor. The same steps that led you up here will lead you right back down again.
At least on that we can agree.
Yes, yes, we can. Rashad! Rashad, get a driver for Dr. King. He wishes to leave.
It would be my pleasure.
And you have a pleasant trip home.
I shall. And thank you very much for the lecture on unity.
You're quite welcome, and before you leave, you should know this, that my religion teaches me not to embarrass even mine own enemy. I let you beat me that second time in arm wrestling.
My religion teaches me to be merciful, especially to my enemies. I let you win the first time. It seemed the Christian thing to do.
Don't forget your lunch.
It's not mine, it's a gift.
Gift?
Is this what you brought me for protection? What is a doll got magical powers? Is it nonviolent also, Doctor?
It's not for you, Malcolm. It's for your daughter. My family and I were watching television, and when the report came over about your bombing, you were standing on the lawn with one of your daughters.
Pavla.
My daughter wondered if everything had been destroyed when she found out I was coming here tonight. She thought Adela could use a friend. It's her favorite doll. She loves it very much. If it has any magical qualities, I suppose it's because of that.
What's her name?
I don't know that it has.
No, I'm not talking about your daughter.
Yolanda.
Yolanda. How old is she?
Nine.
Adela six, she loves this. Yes, she really loves this. Yeah, Martin, you tell your daughter, you tell Yolanda?
Yeah.
That Adela said, now you tell her thanks for both of us.
Dr. King?
You've been to the mountaintop. You got a moment? I'd like to share mine with you. That could be, well, it could be my present to you.
Well, I could hardly refuse an offer like that.
I want you to see when I see.
From out there?
Yeah, what's the matter?
Well, I've never been partial to heights.
You're not afraid of high places now, are you, Reverend?
No, I didn't say I was afraid. I said I wasn't partial.
Now, don't that be... Problems all seem smaller from out here. More manageable. This may not be the country, Reverend, but there are some things that you can love more than the land.
Like the people on it?
Yeah. Yeah, like the people.
Son of a bitch. I think I just got a promotion. You're not gonna believe this. Take a look who's standing on the balcony. I'm gonna have to call him on this. He's gonna wanna know right away. Crazy old man's gonna have a fit.
You gonna wake him up to tell him that Malcolm X is on the balcony?
What, are you crazy? Look who he's standing with.
So?
That's all you gotta say? So?
Jesus Christ, what the hell is Malcolm X doing standing on a balcony with Martin Luther King? What's so funny?
I suppose it's true what they say. We all look alike to you.
What are you talking about?
I hope your boss has a sense of humor.
That's not Dr. King?
No, he looks a little like him, but he's a store owner. He lives up the street. He's visited Malcolm before.
You serious?
Serious as a heart attack, which is what you're going to have after your boss finds out that you're wrong.
You sure?
Look, you want to call him, go ahead. But if he asks me what I saw, I'll have to tell him.
You don't know how close I just came to changing careers. Hey, I owe you one.
Forget it. Just glad I could help.
You know, when my home was bombed, I didn't feel fear as much as I did loneliness and emptiness. I knew it was a warning, but I knew I couldn't turn back.
The bombing of my house was no warning.
Malcolm. Why did you ask me here?
Maybe I needed to see if you'd come.
Another test.
No, Martin, another chance. You've never really hated yourself, have you? You really have no way of knowing how a people who have come to despise themselves think about the world. I know what happens when you finally give up on everything and love nothing at all. I was lucky. I found something to believe in. Something to love. Martin, you can't make it easy for them. You can't just let them think they can kill you and get away with it. That's the only chance you got.
I can't stop anyone who wants to kill me.
They have to stop themselves. There's only one way that'll happen, if you make the cost of your life too high a price to pay. And for that, you need the people down there, people like them, who will say no more. This one you let live, or else. Maybe I can deliver them to you. I might be the only one who can.
Malcolm, nonviolence is not a strategy you use when it's convenient. It's a way of life.
I hope you're right, Martin. For the sake of our children, I really hope you're right. You know what I really wanted to be?
What?
A lawyer.
For the prosecution or the defense?
Doesn't matter. Either way, I'd probably be held in contempt. Would you do it all over again? I mean, if you had the choice.
I didn't want to do it in the first place. I wanted to lead a church, not a movie. The little woman sat down on the bus. It's amazing what you do when your feet get tired. Mm.
My father was
killed because he spoke out. My mother was institutionalized because some pain deep inside her drowned out the music of this world. I've nothing to leave my family now, no money. Now, not even a home. And still, I wonder if there's more that I can do, more of myself that I can give.
I'm reminded of a story about a young Baptist minister who, having gained his fame and fortune in the North, was asked by his former pastor to come home and deliver a sermon. Well, now, he could hardly refuse. He decided to take his son along, teach him a little something about his history, his roots. Well, when he got there, he proceeded to give the finest sermon that he had ever given in his life. He had the congregation rolling from one emotion to another. When he was finished, the old pastor runs up to him and says, John, that was a truly inspirational sermon. We wish we had something to give you, but as you know, our church is not doing too well. Well, now, John didn't want to embarrass the old man, so he just waved him off and said it was payment enough just being home. Now, as he's walking out the church, he sees a collection box. He reaches into his pocket, pulls out a crisp new $10 bill, puts it in the box. Halfway across the parking lot, the old pastor comes running up to him, says, John, now we know you don't want us to give you anything, but we just want to show you a small token of our appreciation. And with that, he hands him the crisp new $10 bill that John recognizes as the one that he put in the box. He's driving home, turns, looks at his son, smiles confidently, proudly, says, son, I hope this has taught you a lesson. Little boy looks up at him all innocent-eyed and says, yes, it has. If you had given more,
you would have got more. Boy, you Baptist preachers, I'm telling you.
Well, we all got to give more, Malcolm. More than we thought we ever had to. Sometimes, even that's not enough. What are we doing?
I think we ought to declare a winner.
If we can't have a truce, I suppose we ought to have a winner.
Oh, come on, Martin. We're arm wrestling. We're not running no relay races.
You warm up the way you want. I warm up the way I want. You know, whoever wins in here won't necessarily be the winner outside.
If I had thought that, I'd have invited you over here a long time ago, Martin. Look out, the old man's taking charge.
He didn't bring me here to have me turn around now.
Quoting scripture's not gonna help you.
Can't hurt.
How long do you think we can continue this?
What?
I said, how long?
Not long. I'm willing to call it a draw if you are.
Okay, you stop first.
No, I'm from the country, Malcolm, but give me some credit.
All right, I'll count to three. One.
Wait, are you going to do all the counting?
All right, we'll alternate.
No, they taught me in school that three is an odd number.
All right, I'll start, and then you go next, and then we'll finish at the same time. Agree?
Agree.
One. I said one!
Two.
Three.
Malcolm, is everything all right? We've been waiting for Dr. King.
I guess I should be letting you go.
Yeah.
It's getting late.
I suppose so.
Rashad, would you give the doctor a hand with this coat?
Oh, no. Thank you. I can manage.
Wonderful.
Yeah, I'll give you a hand with that. Rashad, I'll accompany you downstairs and... We have a cart. They'll take you wherever you need to go.
I appreciate that.
You know, we could have made quite a team.
Malcolm, we do make quite a team. Most people just don't realize it.
Yeah. Well, may they stay ignorant just a little while longer.
Oh, amen to that.
All praises to Allah.
Malcolm, do you want more time together? To exchange prayers with your friend?
Rashad, I'm ready when you are.
I never meant to hurt you by anything I ever said publicly, Martin. It was very important to me that you know that.
It's important to me that you said it.
Well, at least we got to climb one mountain together, huh? Take good care of yourself, Martin.
Goodbye, Malcolm.
Malcolm. Is there anything I can do? Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum. Salam.
Protect the dreamer.
Hi, it's me. Yes, I'm fine. Are you okay? Betty, I'm sorry I can't be there with you, but you know that, don't you? Yeah.
Next week, when I speak at the Audubon, I want you to be there.
I want the whole family to be there. I'm going to speak on brotherhood. And then we'll spend more time together. Oh, I promise. Yes, Betty. I love you. Don't know what love is. Until you've learned the meaning of the blues. Until you've loved the love you've had to lose. You don't know what love is. Let's go home.